Chris. I run an ad tech consulting business called Jounce Media. We work primarily with in-house marketing teams. We also work with media companies and some ad tech companies as well. But we're focused just on advertising technology, and we get asked this question a lot. Marketers want to understand in a rigorous way, how do I make a choice about whether bringing ad tech in-house is a good idea for me? And how do I also, if the answer to that question is yes, how do I figure out how to successfully bring advertising technology investments in-house? By way of background, this is the primary thing that we make. We make little black books. They describe how ad tech works. There are 11 of them. They are available on our website for free download. This is how we start every engagement with every client, whether we're running a workshop for a publisher sales team or we're starting an in-house process with an enterprise marketer. We're pretty committed to starting with education, and so we build off of these little black books a common understanding with our clients of how ad tech works, even more nuts and bolts, just a common language. Like, what are the words we're going to use to describe different things? We're really committed to starting with education, and then we build from there. So we work with a bunch of marketers who have chosen to bring advertising technology in-house. The way they do it's always different. We're going to unpack a bunch of that in this conversation. Here's a specific thing that I heard from one client, which always sticks with me, because I think a lot of our other clients who don't say it feel this way as well. This client said to us, we're really struggling. We don't know. We know we're buying differently. We know we're behaving differently from the average marketer. But because we've brought everything in-house, we don't know if we're buying differently because we're so smart or because we're so stupid. And I think that's what happens. This is the inevitable outcome of bringing advertising technology in-house. You create the opportunity to differentiate, but when you're different, you don't know if you're different in a good way or in a brutally inefficient way. So that's what we're going to talk about. This is going to be the first slide. We're going to come back to this at the very end. That's the thing that I think marketers wrestle with when you debate whether or not to bring ad tech stuff in-house. So here's what we're going to do this thing. I think there's just a ton of noise in the industry, and it's really, really messy and not well organized. So bear with me. I'm going to give you all the messy reasons why people are bullish about bringing ad tech in-house. And then I'm going to give you all the messy reasons in a pretty disorganized way why people are bearish about bringing advertising technology in-house. And then I'm going to try to propose a framework for how to think about the benefits and the risks and quantifying which ones are the benefits big enough for your brand to overcome the risks for your brand. So here's the bull case. Everybody's seen this thing. This was the big catalyst. 2016, the ANA commissions this report produced by a company called K2, and it sort of blows the lid off a bunch of things that people were suspicious was maybe happening in agencies for a long time related to both non-disclosed fees and other forms of non-transparent operating practices. Not every agency played these dirty tricks, but all of their reputations got tarnished. And brands started to think about, what is the relationship I have with my agency? Can I really trust these guys to be my agent, or do I need to take control of the way that I reach consumers in the digital realm? Marketers were primed for this because a year before the ANA report came out, there was this thing that the press loved to cover called Media Palooza. Everybody remember Media Palooza? There were all these brands who did these reviews of their agencies. $25 billion got put up in a jump ball. Some of these brands did change their agency of record. Some of these brands kept some of their agencies and hired new ones or reorganized the way they were going to partner with agencies. Maybe it was more on a project basis. Some of these brands brought functions in-house. But I think for me as an observer of the industry at the time, and I think other brands felt the same way, the biggest lesson that came out of this, most of these brands didn't change anything. They just stayed with their incumbent agency. And sometimes it's because they love their agency. They realize, like, we really do have the best agency partner that we could. But sometimes it's because they realized they were stuck. Like, the agency had just so many hooks into their marketing operations that they couldn't switch. There was this, just this vendor switching friction. And they begrudgingly stayed with their agencies rather than making an active decision like, this is a great partnership. So this thing in 2015, plus the ANA report in 2016, caused a lot of brands to rethink how they buy digitally. And this is not, by the way, just about DSP buying. It certainly includes DSP buying, but it's search, it's buying in the walled gardens, it's negotiating direct buys, it's a data management platform, it's attribution, the whole thing. The whole ad tech apparatus is under review within a lot of brands from a position primarily of concerns that the old model isn't working anymore. So let me walk you through the framework that we walk our clients through when they think about sort of re-architecting their ad tech stack. This is our picture of how a programmatic ad gets transacted. Starts with the publisher, walk your way back from there. An ad becomes available on, in this picture, it looks like a website. It could be a website, it could be an app, it could be a connected TV. A piece of inventory becomes available. The publisher hands that piece of inventory off to its publisher ad server. Publisher ad server does some complicated things and potentially decides to conduct an auction through an ad exchange. The ad exchange sends bid requests to DSPs, which we call bidders. Speaking of precise language, we call them bidders. The bidder of the DSP bids into that auction, and if it wins, it then owns this piece of real estate, hands off the impression to the advertiser ad server, which serves the ad, and then assuming audience data was used somewhere along the way to target this impression, the advertiser is supposed to send along a privacy notice and an opt-out to the consumer. Those five things happen 100% of the time. Additionally, it is optional and very, very common for the marketer to also supply data into its bidder to make smarter ad buying decisions. That usually comes from a data management platform. And then last, it's very, very common for the marketer to send data out of this system to an attribution system or another measurement platform in order to determine whether the money we just spent produced the business outcome that we care about. So that's the whole thing. And most of this is buy-side technology. Most of this picture represents technology that the advertiser is responsible for sourcing and operating. It's like a lot of stuff to manage. There's your shopping list. It's a DSP and an ad server. Maybe you need to buy an opt-out system, although that probably comes packaged with your DSP. Maybe you need a data management platform. And maybe you need one or potentially even multiple measurement systems, one for viewability, one for audience verification, one for multi-touch attribution. It's like a lot of things on your shopping list. Like, this is complicated. But I think coming out of 2015 and 2016, brands felt like, well, this is complicated whether or not we own it. If somebody else owns it, specifically if our agency owns it, it's so complicated we can't move. We're stuck. We've lost our ability to be nimble. And so the bull case would say, yes, it's complicated. You have to own this. The bull case would also say, yes, you have to own this, but if you own it, you get all kinds of other upside. You don't just protect from the downside of being stuck with your agency. You unlock all of this ability to differentiate. And specifically, you differentiate because you own your data. So when you own all of this technology, you might as well buy one more thing on your shopping list. You might as well license some cloud infrastructure from Amazon or Google or Microsoft, and then pipeline all of your marketing data into this data warehouse that you now own. Like, when you add up the bill of all of your non-working media, this is a total rounding error that creates so much upside for your business. So add one more thing to your shopping list. Take all of your ad server data and pipe it in. Now you've got records of every ad you serve, every click that happened, and every visit to your website. The reality is most marketers don't only work with DoubleClick. They probably buy ads from a bunch of companies that don't play nice with DoubleClick. So let's cook up some ways to get data from those companies sourced into our data warehouse and ideally stitch it together with a common user ID. Easier said than done, but doable. You probably also engage some third party to measure the quality of the inventory you're buying. Moat, IAS, DoubleVerify. Let's get some data from them. Pipe that into the data warehouse. Let's do the same thing for any kind of verification companies that might measure things like audience accuracy or brand sentiment. And to the extent we have offline data, either because we're an offline business or because we do offline marketing, let's onboard that data through a partner like a LiveRamp or a Neustar or an Oracle, stitch this thing all together in our data warehouse, and now we, the marketer, own the master set of all of our data. That unlocks a ton of interesting capabilities. It makes us much more able to understand our consumer journey, makes us much more equipped to implement smart optimization, and it really unlocks our ability to have any dependency on a single vendor because we own the master set of our data. Once you have this master data set, you can do three things. One, you can write a bunch of SQL queries or use other languages, but you can actually inspect your data in a way that you never could before. Two, once you have great ways of doing that and you really have developed repeatable pieces of analysis that are insightful for your business, automate it and surface it through dashboards so like normal human beings who don't know how to write SQL can still benefit from this data warehouse. And then last, keep in mind that you own the master copy and you syndicate copies out to any of your partners. Let me share two examples of this last thing that we're working on currently. I think they're both super, super powerful. One, hire a multi-touch attribution partner to build you a great view of incrementality, but do not give them the master data set. Take data from your data warehouse, pipeline it out to your multi-touch attribution partner, and have them pipeline attribution scores back in. That's not like an idea. That's a thing that's happening right now for multiple brands. Two, take those attribution scores. Take your understanding of what marketing really is effective and ship it out to your DSP. Pipeline it out to DBM. Pipeline it out to MediaMath and have them customize the way that they bid based on your proprietary data. More generally, make data a competitive advantage. Okay, there's one more thing that the bulls say. The bulls say, this is insane. If you're a brand manager, or even worse, if you're a CMO and you're responsible for allocating money, you need fast and unfiltered insight into how your investments are behaving. This is what happens today. I used to work at Turn. Another woman from my team, Danielle, worked at Zaxis at the time. That's how we originally met. Here's what would happen when we worked together. Something would happen in Turn, the DSP, that required feedback, either a good thing or a bad thing. But something would happen in Turn, the DSP, that required the brand to weigh in. Someone on my ad ops team at Turn would get alerted. They would escalate that to me. Then I would be responsible for reaching out to Danielle, who worked at the agency trading desk. She would escalate it to her boss. Her boss would then liaise with the agency. His contact at the agency would escalate to that person's boss. And then finally, the brand manager would be notified. And then maybe after that, the CMO gets notified as well. And I think a lot of CMOs are saying, like, can we just like do this? Like, can't we just, this should be achievable. And maybe I don't want to know about every click tracking issue, but I want to know about some things, and I want to know really fast, and I want it to be automated. Like, can't we do this? And the answer is like, yes, you can definitely do this. And then additionally, when I want to send instructions back to my campaign, when I make a decision in an important meeting, let's not go through that ridiculous chain of command to implement this change. Let's just do this. Like, can't we just have somebody from my business who like logs into the DSP and makes a change? And like, yes, you can definitely do this. You might not want to do it every time. You might not want to be trafficking every creative, but absolutely, you can rapidly implement changes in your DSP. You don't need that really, really long chain of command. So I think that's what the bulls say. The bears say, like, okay, maybe, but you think you're gonna capture all those benefits. And we've seen this before. You're going to walk away from your agency, and you're going to be crawling back 1 year later, because this thing is so much more complicated than you think it is. That sounded really easy. This thing is not easy. Here's how this thing really goes. First of all, have you thought about the economics of in-housing? Have you considered the fact that when you buy through an agency trading desk, you are benefiting from the collective bargaining power of that agency trading desk, who's negotiated an 8% take rate with their DSP? I don't know how big your budget is, but even if you're P&G, you don't have the same buying power as an agency trading desk. And so you need to expect that the DSP is going to charge you less favorable rates than what they give to their mega agency trading desk customers. This is real math from a project we worked on recently. Big budget, $20 million of DSP ad spend a year. Under the agency trading desk's 8% take rate, the fee to the DSP to manage that money, the tech fee to execute it, is $1.3 million. Bring that in-house and assume a 14% take rate, your out-of-pocket cost of the DSP has climbed to $2.9 million. You've got a $1.4 million gap to close. And what do you need to believe to close that gap? You've got to save a lot of money in personnel. You've got to achieve a lot of buying efficiencies. Like, do you really believe you can close a $1.4 million fee gap? Also, it's not just about the absolute amount of cost, it's about the shape of the cost. This is roughly a media plan from one of our clients. I'd imagine it looks like a lot of media plans. Q4 is really busy. And so over the course of the year, we have these ups and downs and this big bang in Q4. If this brand with this media plan outsourced this DSP budget to a managed service partner, their service fees would have this shape. They would be charged on a percent of media basis for service. And in the quiet times of year, their service fee would be low. And in the busy time of year, their service fee would be high. It all moves in proportion to their budget. But if they staff a full-time team to bring this thing in-house, their costs look like this. Total cost might be higher or lower, but the shape is flat. you are writing a payroll check, you're pushing payroll every 2 weeks, and you never get it right. For the first 9 months of the year, that team is underutilized. And for the last 3 months of the year, they're pulling their hair out because they're so understaffed. When you staff a full-time team, you just can't scale in the way that a big outsourced partner can. That's the cost. Let's also just talk about the complexity. What's your plan for making sure that you maintain expertise on the current state of header bidding? How are you going to stay on top of these announcements from exchanges that they're moving from second price auctions to first price auctions? What's the plan for maintaining expertise in multi-touch attribution models, staying on top of domain spoofing and the ads.txt program? How are you going to just be aware of all of the innovation that's happening in the industry so that you stay at the edge of that innovation curve and don't fall behind? How are you going to get talent? If you're based in Minnesota and you're trying to staff an in-house team, where are you going to get those people? And do you think you can pay them more than Google's going to pay them? Because Google definitely wants the best ad tech talent in every market. And so are you prepared to get into a talent war with some of the big ad tech companies and media publishers? Do you really think you can bring in the right talent? And even once you bring them in, like, how are you going to train them? How are you going to maintain their expertise? How are you going to retain these people and not have them use your in-house marketing team as a springboard to go and get a high-paying job somewhere else? How about inventory access? You know, we talked about the favorable rates that a big agency trading desk can negotiate. They can negotiate more than just favorable rates with an ad tech company. They can negotiate priority with publishers. Xaxis has huge deals in place with NBC and ESPN and Hearst and HuffPost and a dozen other publishers. And when they bid into an auction and you bid into the auction and you both send the same price, they win. And how are you going to overcome that? How are you going to make sure that your brand has access to the inventory that you need? By the way, there's a really similar picture that we haven't drawn that you could draw for data. They have preferential access to special audiences that are just not available off the shelf in your DSP. How are you going to overcome all these barriers? And then the last thing is all the little things. What's your plan for enforcing brand safety? Whose job is it going to be at your company to monitor brand safety like a maniac and make sure that you're all over your blacklist? What's your plan for detecting when publishers have blacklisted you for their auctions? Let me just build that one in a little bit more detail. Private marketplaces, they break all the time. It's getting better, but it's getting better really, really slowly. You set up a private marketplace and it doesn't deliver. Within an agency trading desk or another outsourced services organization, there is a human whose full-time job is to make sure he understands all of the reasons why private marketplaces don't deliver. And each time a private marketplace launches and something goes wrong, bang, he's on it, he figures it out, it goes through his checklist, solved, it's delivering. Who's the person at your company that's going to do that? Can you justify having somebody build that level of expertise? Or are you just going to be stuck like troubleshooting private marketplaces that aren't delivering all day long? So like I said, I think that was really messy. That's what I hear in the industry all the time. Like all these little like sound bites here and there. So we spent a bunch of time trying to organize this thing, like put some structure around these benefits and these risks. And I think they fall into these three categories. The bulls say you will achieve huge financial benefits, strategic benefits, and operational benefits by in-housing. And the bears say exactly the opposite. Like you're not seeing the risks. There are huge financial risks, there are huge strategic risks, and there are huge operational risks. Let's talk about the benefits that are possible to achieve. The bulls would say, when you in-house, you get fee transparency and operational transparency. Additionally, and critically, you create the incentive to perform. When you outsource your media execution, you incentivize another company to grow your media budget. And when you bring things in-house, you create an incentive to achieve high ROI. Strategically, your biggest benefit is partner flexibility. You no longer have hooks that make you stuck with any partner, whether it's your agency or a tech partner or somebody else. You have the ability to have full vendor flexibility. You also have dedicated staff who become experts in your business and think about how to market your brand in a way that is unique to your brand. And you have roadmap ownership. To say this last point differently, you have the ability to be differentiated. You can create, you can use data as a competitive advantage here. Operationally, you get two big benefits as well. You get direct access to the technology that you're using. That chain of command gets really short and efficient. And the last thing is you get centralized decision making. There's no longer ambiguity about like, well, who's authorized to make the decision? It's one central buying team that has full authority to make decisions. Those are big benefits, and they're all real. But these are big risks, and they're all real too. So the bulls would say, financially, make sure you're considering the rates that you're going to pay for technology, because you don't have the same collective bargaining power that an agency trading desk group would. And make sure that you consider the shape of those costs as well. You go from a variable cost model to a fixed cost model. Strategically, make sure that you're considering what these innovation blind spots might be, where you fall behind the innovation curve. What's your plan for staying up? And also, what's your plan for making sure that you have the access you need to both inventory, publishers, and audience data? And then last, operationally, you're going to feel like you're fighting with one arm tied behind your back. You're going to have challenges recruiting and training and retaining the best talent. You're going to be self-insured. When your agency trading desk makes a trafficking error today and accidentally spends $100,000, that's their $100,000. That's about to become your $100,000. And additionally, it's all the little things. You are going to be constantly reinventing the wheel that your competitors who work with the trading team are able to share across all of their different brands. To say it differently, the bulls say you have the opportunity to be efficient, innovative, and nimble. And the bears say the reality of this thing is it's going to be expensive. You're going to get sidelined from the innovation in the industry, and you're going to be fighting with one hand tied behind your back. They're all right. The question is, how big are these risks for your brand, and how well can you mitigate them? And I think one of the things that surprised me, I guess, in going through lots of these projects with lots of different brands of different shapes and sizes and locations, the benefits aren't that different from one brand to the next. Like, all brands have an equal opportunity to achieve those benefits. Not all brands have an equal penalty on these risks. And I think what we've seen is there are three characteristics of a brand that indicate how risk-prone they are, how big these risks are for their brand. There's the size of the business. That's kind of the obvious one. You know, if you're P&G, some of these financial penalties aren't as big as if you're a very small, new startup. Timing is a less obvious one. Brands that are seasonal incur lots of penalties here. Brands that are super steady don't. If you have an always-on, smooth marketing schedule, it's a lot easier to bring buying in-house than if you're an e-commerce brand with high seasonality. And then the last one here is the location of your business. Sort of obvious as well. If you're based in New York City, you have some real advantages. Maybe your office space costs more, but all those talent things get a lot easier for you. If you're based in a tier two or a tier three city, talent becomes quite a bit of a bigger challenge. So does having access to the innovation in the industry. People love to talk about Netflix and say that Netflix has hit a total home run here. And like, credit to those guys. They have done things extraordinarily well. They also had the lowest risks possible. They're a huge marketer. They are as steady as you could be. And they're located in a tier one city. And so they didn't have to fight as much of an uphill battle as other brands do. I don't take any credit away from Netflix. They've done amazing work. But keep them in mind as the example of the brand that has the easiest time being successful in housing. Let's talk about three mitigation strategies. We'll wrap up here and then I'll open up for questions. There's lots of ways to mitigate these risks. But I think there's three that we see are both really, really effective and really repeatable across different brands. I said something earlier about using data as a competitive advantage. This is just like so not where I come from. But I think one of the things that I've seen through our work with Jounce is procurement can be a competitive advantage as well. There are things that brands can agree to when they procure technology that agencies just can't. And that creates a lot of value for their partners, which enables the brand to achieve better economics. And like, really savvy procurement people make a big difference in whether in-housing is really viable. I love this example. This is like Kellogg's just recognizing like everything they needed to do to get a sweetheart deal. They wrote a press release, and they publicly named this like super clever, cutting-edge thing that they're doing that's made possible by the combined efforts of Moat and Yahoo and Nielsen Catalina. I have no idea what the terms of this agreement are, but I'll bet you they're not paying rate card for whatever this thing is. Press releases are just one way that brands can be really clever with procurement. Prepayment, it's really hard for agencies to do. A lot of these ad tech companies have cash flow challenges. They love prepayment. That creates real value for their businesses, and a lot of in-house brands can justify prepayment. Long contract terms, that's another one that creates a ton of value for ad tech vendors that sometimes brands can sign up for that agencies can't. The last one is just the payment mechanism. Ad tech companies really, really, really want SaaS revenues. if the contract can be structured in a way where the ad tech vendor can classify it as subscription revenue, that creates extraordinary enterprise value for them without costing the brand much more. All these things together enable a marketer to overcome some of these challenges about, you know, the favorable rates that agency trading desks are able to negotiate. So procurement as a competitive advantage. The three-legged stool model, people love to talk about this one, and it really is effective. Let me give you three examples that are all similar in the sense that the brand has captured a lot of the benefits of working directly with technology partners, but it's outsourced the service. The Hartford's a big insurance company. They use Crux as their data management platform. It's their system of record for all their targeting data. But they've authorized their agency, Horizon Media, to use that DMP. Still have an agency. Presumably, they still have a really healthy relationship with their agency, but they own the tech. Similarly, Domino's in the measurement space. Domino's uses DoubleClick attribution, formerly Odometry, for attribution, but they authorize their agency, Mindshare, to use that attribution system to inform optimization decisions. Last one here for execution. When I was at Turn, we were really, really excited about this. Kraft signed a direct deal with Turn to use Turn as their DSP, and then authorized Starcom to use the DSP. This is a pretty sweet setup for a brand. You get a lot of the benefits that we've talked about. You don't have to incur some of those risks. Agencies don't love this. These agencies are highly fireable. I don't think they have been fired. They're doing good work. But they don't have the hook anymore that makes it impossible for them to be fired. So this three-legged stool model works really nicely for a brand, sometimes causes a little bit of disruption with agency relationships. Here's the last one. This is so new to me. I don't know why I didn't see this one. But these brands are talking to each other. Like, a lot of the challenges that I outlined here relate to some assumption that, like, you're out there living on an island. You don't need to live on an island. I think it's pretty unlikely that Allstate and Geico are going to share information about their marketing plans. But Allstate and 1-800-Flowers are very happy to share data with each other, share information, share best practices. There are these networks of in-house marketing teams that have quarterly conference calls, and they go through, like, what have we learned? What are the new emerging things that are working? What's a big mistake I made that you should make sure you don't make? Brands don't have to just live on an island. They can talk to each other. Procurement is a competitive advantage. Three-legged stool model. Collaborating with other in-house teams. I think those three are pretty broadly applicable. And like I said, there's others. The question here has two parts. One is, are the benefits big enough to overcome the risks? But two is, can we make the risks smaller? Like, what can we do to mitigate those risks as much as possible so that we can capture the full upside of the benefits without incurring too many penalties from these risks? And I think if you do that well, the answer here becomes, you're so smart. To the extent that you're able to capture all that upside, mitigate the risks, talk with other brands, use procurement as a competitive advantage, be able to take advantage of all of the data as a competitive differentiator opportunities. Brands who behave differently do it because they really are being so smart, and you can feel reasonably confident and not feel like you're lost in the woods.